Welcome to this node breakdown for MARDINI 2024 with Grayscale Gorilla. This is day 20, and today's node is the Ragdoll Solver SOP. So this is a SOP level geometry node, so we can dive inside here and just create a Ragdoll Solver. As you can see, this requires two inputs, a skeleton and some collision shapes. So this actually requires some setup because we're going to need to take a character and set it up for Ragdoll solving. So you can use either Electra or Capybara. Either of those are decent geometries to use for this. But what I'm going to do is use an FBX character import and just bring in an animation from Mixamo. So over here, I'm just going to go and grab this strut walking. And we just have this over here. I'm going to choose the clip. So this is the walking clip. And you won't see anything yet. That's because this defaults to showing the first output, which is the rest geometry. To see what each one of these outputs are, I'm going to add three nulls over here. The first one over here, you can see it's just the rest geometry. So we can call this rest geo. The second one over here is just going to be our skeleton. So rest skeleton. And the third one over here is actually going to be our animation. So we can call this animation skeleton. Now, the first thing that we need to do is we need to take the skeleton and we need to define some limits for it. When I say limits, all I mean is what angle can these joints bend in? And that's going to be important because certain joints only have certain ranges of motion. For example, an elbow can't bend backwards. And that's going to be important because when we put it into the Ragdoll solver, that's going to define how much of a range of motion each joint has. It's going to be constrained to a particular range of motion. To do that, we need to use a configure joints node, this one right over here. And this is once again going to take one input. We're also going to use a rigs-pose. This is going to set up our rest geometry. And let's just go ahead and take the second output and put that to our skeleton. So to set up the limits for these joints, the first thing that we want to do is take a look at our rotation order. So we're going to change this to YZX, like that. And over here, we don't actually want full body IK. We want this to be ragdoll. All right, so ragdoll and RY, RZ, RX. Now, when we click on a particular joint in our viewport with our transform handles, it'll show up like this. And this is just what we're going to use to define the ranges for our joints. So we're going to go through each joint and just give it some sort of range, right? So how much can each joint move in a particular axis? And for a lot of them, we're going to set up in multiple axes. So you can see over here that this joint over here can move in this entire area represented by the mesh. And that's going to be the shoulder, which moves more or less in that range. So it's fairly straightforward. We're just going to set this up for a couple of our joints. It doesn't have to be for all of them, but we do want it for many of the important joints. And this doesn't have to be perfectly accurate. We can come back and make adjustments to it afterwards. This is just some initial setup. So once we have it all set up, you'll see them appear over here under our configurations. So we'll have a bunch of configurations set up. So that sets up the limits for our joints. The next thing that we want is actually the collision for this geometry. To do that, we're going to use the ragdoll collision shapes. And this over here takes a skeleton into first input so we can take our configured joints. And then it needs a rest geometry. So we're going to grab that from our rest geo over here into the third input. But if we click on our transform handles, you'll see that it generates this convex hull for us. Now this over here is a decomposition of our rest geo, because if we were to actually simulate with our rest geo, it would be very complex. This over here is much simpler and actually works perfectly with the Ragdoll solver, which under the hood is actually an RBD solver. So over here, we can do some cleanup. You can view your intersections if you click on display intersections. You can also go over here and change the shape to convex hull and enable handle. This will allow you to make changes to each shape and avoid any intersections. And if we have situations like this where these fingers are made up of lots of shapes, we can just go ahead and click and drag over a bunch of them and actually merge their convex hull with their parent. So we can turn each finger into just a single convex hull, right? So you select everything except the one that you want it to join to, and it joins it into single ones like this. So it's just a useful way to avoid too many shapes. Once we have this, we can go ahead and take this into the first input of the Ragdoll solver and the collision shapes into second. And you'll see that it all gathers at the bottom. Just say reset simulation, and that will set it up for us. Now, if you play this back, your character will just fall, but that's fine. We can add a ground plane over here, play this back, and your character will now collapse. Hopefully respecting the joint limits that you've set up for it. As you can see, it just falls over, right? So if you're finding that there's too much range of motion in a particular joint, you can go ahead, go back to your joint configure over here and make some adjustments. Okay, so how do we actually take this animation that we have over here and feed it into our Ragdoll solver? Because right now our character is just kind of falling over. Usually we would want it to at least respect the animation in some way. So we can do that. But the first thing that I'm going to do is make this loopable. So all we're going to use is a motion clip. Plug this in over here, choose the frame range, We're just going to set this to frame 34 because I know that that's the last frame of this animation. Put this into a motion clip evaluate and then just set this end behavior over here to loop. If we now play this back, you'll see that it perfectly loops. So how do we apply this to our ragdoll solver? Well, what we want is to firstly adjust the skeleton that's going in. So we can use a skeleton blend over here. So we take this one, plug it into first input, and we take our animation into second input. And now all we have to do is disable scale over here, and we can then switch between the T-pose and the animation, right? So if I play this back, you can see that this is T-posed animation, right? So we're just blending between the two. This can then go into the ragdoll solver. Now, immediately, you won't really notice anything other than its starting pose being a little bit different. So it'll just fall from a different starting pose. But what you can do is you can start using the settings on this ragdoll solver to now make adjustments to how it uses the animation. So over here, under the configurations, just add a new one. And as for group over here, we can choose a particular joint. But I'm just going to put asterisk, and that just means use every possible joint, and then match the world transforms of that joint. Now, if you play it back, you'll see that it perfectly uses our animation. The cool thing is we can now keyframe this. So let's just say that we have it walking for 24 frames, keyframe the positional stiffness, and then at frame 27, drop this to zero. Right. So now if you play it back, it'll just collapse at that frame. Another interesting thing that you can do with this, which is really cool, is you can just choose some joints. So let's go over here and just choose a couple of these joints. And I'm just going to choose the leg joints, right? So only the leg joints are going to be matched to the animation. And what you end up with is this zombie type effect, right? So how do we actually use this? Well, all we have to now do is use a joint deform. And with this joint deform, you take the animated skeleton into the last input over here. And then you take the rest skeleton into the second input and the geometry into the first, right? So geometry, rest skeleton, animated skeleton. And now we have this over here. Now, the other thing to note about this is that if you add a new configuration afterwards, it will override any conflicting configurations. So if I had to add something to the legs and then have this one over here also affect them, then it'll use the second one rather than the first. But what's cool is that we can also make it use the upper body. So let's just select the upper body over here, press enter, match world transforms, and reduce the position stiffness to something like 5. So now it'll more or less respect this. The other thing that we can change is the general bend stiffness and bend damping over here. So the bend stiffness, if we drop this to something like 0.5, you're going to see that it's a bit weird and everything's extremely floppy. You can see it in the wrists over there. If you push it up to something like 20, everything's going to be a lot more rigid. Now, bend damping is going to define how long it takes to come back to its original position. You can see we also have position damping over here. And so if you push this up, it'll take longer to correct back to its original position. Finally, the last input over here on the ragdoll solver is for colliders. So if we go ahead and just add a cube, just going to template it over here. I'm going to go ahead and just move it, set a keyframe for it, and then just move it past our character, right? Plug that into the ragdoll solver and let's see what it does. Now, as you can see, it's going to have some issues. There are a couple of ways to fix that. We can, of course, increase our substeps. So let's increase this to something like 50. Right, and that's sort of working, but what we want is also some damping, right? So let's take a look at some other options that we have. Perhaps we can decrease the strength of the legs. We can allow higher damping on a couple of these and also just push up our constraint iterations, something like 50. So as you can see, we now have this where the character is pushed back and then he just continues walking. So I'm including this file down below for download because this is quite a bit of setup. But what's cool about this is that this should work for any sort of Mixamo character that you bring in. So if we just go over here to the strut walking, I also have this breakdancing one over here. All I would do is just disable the motion clip and motion clip evaluate over here, because I don't want this to loop, right? The other thing is I'll just disable this box, right? So we have that over there. Perhaps you can remove the constraints on the upper body, change this to once again affecting all of them. And then you can do something like disabling your position stiffness at a particular point. And you just have something like that. If you want, you can also wire forces into it. If you double click over here, you can see that we can wire pop forces. So it's a super cool node to work with, lots of fun, but you do have to do a bit of setup over here. So once again, this file is available for download if you don't want to have to go through all of this yourself. And this does work with other geometries. For example, the capybara, the only thing you'd have to do is reconfigure the joints over here. It will be different if you're not using a Mixamo geometry. I'll duplicate this over and have one for Electra as well, so you can play around with that. But that's all for this video. I'll be seeing you tomorrow with the Vellum Cloth Sop.